men. Well, last week we wrapped up a series on the foundations of the faith, and we went back to the basics, if you remember, and just look at some real fundamental things about Christianity. And we looked at what it means to be a Christian. What is a Christian? The definition of what is a Christian. And we looked at the definition of what is a church member. And I scrunched those down as much as I could. I certainly could have stretched that out for a number of weeks. But I wanted to begin this week with our new series on the Gospel of Matthew. And as we begin looking at the Gospel of Matthew, feel free to begin turning there as I discuss this. The Gospel of Matthew writes his Gospel and he directs his Gospel at Israel. And his purpose in writing the Gospel of Matthew is to demonstrate to Israel that Jesus is their promised Messiah. And what he does is he goes back to the Old Testament repeatedly and he pulls scripture from the Old Testament and says, look, here's a prophecy on who Messiah is, and here, look, Jesus fulfilled that. He goes back again and says, here's something that it says that Messiah will do, and then he brings it forward and says, oh, look, here's what Jesus did, and you see he's fulfilled that. And so as we begin the Gospel of Matthew, as we look at it, we need to understand that this genealogy that's listed here at the beginning of Matthew is not to give notoriety to a bunch of very difficult names to pronounce. It's not about that. What it's about is demonstrating, as we read, and it begins, you'll see, with the genealogy beginning with Abraham, that Jesus is the heir to what is promised to Abraham. And ultimately, what the text tells us about what is promised to Abraham, it's a blessing that you and I enjoy. And so if you will, follow along with me as I read the genealogy of Jesus Christ, beginning in chapter 1, in verse 1 of the Gospel of Matthew. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, and Judah the father of Perez, and Zerah by Tamar, and Perez the father of Hezron, Hezron the father of Ram, Ram the father of Amminadab, and Amminadab the father of Nahshon, and Nahshon the father of Salmon, Salmon the father of Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of David the king. I'm going to pause there for just a moment. Notice that the genealogy incorporates King David, and we're going to look at that promise in the Abrahamic covenant and the Davidic covenant and the covenant that God makes in the Garden of Eden and tie all of these things together with Jesus Christ. Continuing there in verse 6b, and David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah, and Solomon the father of Rehoboam, Rehoboam the father of Abijah, Abijah the father of Asaph, Asaph the father of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat the father of Joram, Joram the father of Uzziah, Uzziah the father of Jotham, and Jotham the father of Ahaz, Ahaz the father of Hezekiah, and Hezekiah the father of Manasseh, Manasseh the father of Amos, Amos the father of Josiah, and Josiah the father of Jeconiah, and his brothers at the time of the deportation to Babylon. And after the deportation to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Shealtiel, and Shealtiel the father of Zerubbabel, Zerubbabel the father of Abiud, and Abiud the father of Eliakim, and Eliakim the father of Azor, Azor the father of Zadok, and Zadok the father of Akim, Akim the father of Eluid, Eluid the father of Eleazar, and Eleazar the father of Matan, and Matan the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called Christ. So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations, and from David to the deportation of to Babylon, 14 generations, and from the deportation to Babylon to the Christ, 14 generations. Only God, friends, the perfection of God in dividing those evenly that way. But why? You know, you're looking at, you read through that in Matthew, and you say, why, if Jesus was fathered by God to Mary, why would Joseph be significant? Why would the significance of this genealogy to Joseph be important? Well, because, friends, you see, through the Father, through the Father, there is a legal heir to the throne. There's this legality of the heir to the throne. Go back, if you will, to Genesis chapter 26 and look in verse 4 of Genesis 26, because you notice that the text began there with the genealogy beginning with Abraham. And in Genesis 26, in verse 4, what we read here is very significant. And perhaps you remember it. Perhaps you even have it memorized. And this is God saying to Abraham, as Abraham believed God, he says in verse 4 of chapter 26 of Genesis, "I will multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven, and will give to your offspring all these lands, and in your offspring all the nations of the earth shall be blessed." Notice that word "all" there, and as we go back, of course, we know that the Old Testament was written in Hebrew, and if I was to look at the Hebrew word for that word "all" there, it would still connote all. All means all. When you read "all" in the Bible, it doesn't mean a certain sect of people, unless it says all the Christians or all the lost. There's a particularization there. But when we read this, it says all the nations will be blessed through you. And we see the promise of that fulfilled here, friends, in the genealogy of Jesus Christ, as we see that the genealogy plays out through Joseph, the legal heir to the throne there through Abraham, as well as, we're going to look at another genealogy here in just a moment. If you will, turn with me over to the Gospel of Luke. And we're going to look in verse 23 of chapter 3 of the Gospel of Luke. Luke 3:23. Jesus, when he began his ministry, was about 30 years of age, being the son, as was supposed, of Joseph, the son of Heli, the son of Mathat, the son of Levi, the son of Melchi, the son of Jannai, the son of Joseph, the son of Matthias, the son of Amos, the son of Nahum, the son of Esli, the son of Nagai, the son of Maath, the son of Matthias, the son of Simeon, the son of Josech, the son of Joda, the son of Jonan, the son of Resha, the son of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, the son of Neri, the son of Melchi, the son of Adai, the son of Kosam, the son of Elminadab, the son of Er, the son of Joshua, the son of Eleazar, the son of Jorim, the son of Mathat, the son of Levi, the son of Simeon, the son of Judah, the son of Joseph, the son of Jonam, the son of Eliakim, the son of Maaseiah, the son of Minah, the son of Mathat, the son of Nathan, the son of David, the son of David, notice, the son of Jesse, the son of Obed, the son of Boaz, the son of Salah, the son of Nishan, the son of Aminadab, the son of Abmin, the son of Arni, the son of Hezron, the son of Perez, the son of Judah, the son of Jacob, the son of Isaac, the son of Abraham. Note, the son of Terah, the son of Nahor, the son of Serug, the son of Reu, the son of Peleg, the son of Eber, the son of Shelah, the son of Canaan, the son of Arpaxad, the son of Shem, the son of Noah, the son of Lamech, the son of Methuselah, the son of Enoch, the son of Jared, the son of Mahalalel, the son of Canaan, the son of Enos, the son of Seth, the son of Adam, the son of God. Now this genealogy goes all the way back to Adam as father directly by God. But notice that both of the genealogies incorporate David the king. David, the man after God's own heart. And if you will, go with me over to 2 Samuel. And in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 12 and following, we're going to look at some text there. 7, 12 and following says this. Again, this is a promise to King David. "When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your fathers, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever." Forever. Now, of course, this is directly speaking of Solomon. We know this, as is notated here in the text that follows this. But ultimately, friends, it plays out through King Jesus. So let's keep reading. I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. When he commits iniquity, I will discipline him with the rod of men, but with the stripes of the Son of Men. Listen, but my steadfast love will not depart from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I put away before you. And here it is, your house, David, and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever. In accordance with all of these words and in accordance with all this vision, Nathan spoke to David. Of course, the prophet Nathan speaks to David as a spokesperson for God. And so we see in the two genealogies, friends, that commonality of King David. So the legal heir, as well as the genetic or the bloodline from both Joseph, legal, and Mary, the bloodline for King Jesus, which goes all the way back to Adam. Why did the genealogy go back to Adam? I'm glad you asked. Let's go back and take a look. Go to chapter 3 of Genesis. And let's look at Genesis 3, and in verse 15, there's a very significant promise that is made all the way back here in the Garden of Eden. Now, just to set the stage here, of course, here's what's happened. Of course, God has warned Adam. God has given Adam specific instructions. He says, you till the garden. You're here to take care of the garden. You can do anything you want. Just do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I always joke about this. I don't really mean it, but I mean, I don't know. I think I could have probably kept that one command. Don't eat that tree. Nevertheless, Eve has not been created yet. So when Eve is created, now we see the scene where the serpent, of course, Satan is there in bodily form as a serpent, is speaking with Eve, and he's having these conversations. He's like, did God really say, don't eat from the tree? And of course, she quotes what her husband says, and then she adds to it and says, we're not supposed to eat it or touch it. She wasn't there. So she had to go by what her husband told her in order to believe what God said. And so there she is in the garden having this conversation with the serpent. And then all of a sudden, of course, we find out that she took some and she ate it and she gave some to her husband who was there with her. There Adam is, got the directive straight from God, and there he is standing there watching her do what God told them both not to do. And of course, we know what happened after that is what we call the fall of man. And the very fiber, friends, the very fiber of the universe was altered at that very moment. And a sin nature was imposed upon humanity, and you and I are prisoners to that until we are regenerated. We talked about that in our previous series about what regeneration is. So here we have it, and of course, what we see is that immediately following that, we hear the sound of God walking in the garden, and what happens? Adam hides. And God says, where are you? Does God know where he is? Of course he does. He says, where are you? So Adam comes out, and he says, God says, what's going on, Adam? He's like, well, I realized I was naked, and I was afraid, and so I hid. He senses the guilt and the fear of judgment, and so he flees from that judgment. If you can flee from judgment of God, which we know we can't. And so God, what does he do? He goes down right down the pecking order. He goes to Adam. You know, I'm Adam, you're the guy I told this to. He's like, the woman you gave me. Right? And then he goes to the woman. He says, what is this you have done? Well, the serpent, right? We play the blame game, right? And so God goes to the serpent, and he makes immediately at the moment where the separation of humanity from God, where man is now flawed and is separated and fell out of fellowship with God, God makes this promise. Listen to what he says here in verse 15 of chapter 3. I will put enmity, talking to the serpent, between you and the woman. Ladies, most of y'all are not really friendly to snakes. kind of wired into your DNA. Okay? I will put, you can say I'm a victim. I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between, listen, your offspring and her offspring. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. Some versions say you shall crush his head. In other words, the prophecy here is the seed of the woman. Now, in Jewish writing, it was always spoken of the seed of the man. Very interesting that it talks about the seed of the woman here. And of course, as we read the Christmas story, we realize that the Holy Spirit came upon Mary, and Mary became pregnant, the seed of the woman. There's the promise, friends. The promise of redemption comes immediately following the fall. And there you have it, friends, is, you see, Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of the Davidic promise, of the Abrahamic promise, and of this promise here in Eden. He is King Jesus, and he is the King of glory and the King of love. And I would love to share this song with you that just speaks to you. Y'all can stand on your feet. Praise the Lord. Praise Jesus. Let the big red job.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. Let heaven and nature sing. All ye faithful, and lift up your praise to the King of the ages, to the Ancient of Days. Sing hallelujah, this King of creation, this King of the nations, and heaven above is the King of salvation, and forever the King of my heart. Hallelujah, this King of glory is our King of love. He's the King of love. Oh! No more let sin and sorrow grow. No thorns infest the ground. As he comes to me, his blessings flow far as the curse is found. Voices, we lift up our hands, cause he's given his people a reason to dance. Hallelujah, this King of creation, this King of the nations, and heaven above is the King of salvation, and forever the King of my heart. Hallelujah, this King of glory is our King of love. He's a warrior, deliverer. He's Emmanuel. He is God with us. He is mighty, mighty, mighty to save us. He's a wonderful counselor. He's a warrior, deliverer. Give glory and honor. Blessed be the name of Jesus from heaven above. He's the King of glory, the King of God. Give glory and honor. Blessed be the name of Jesus. From heaven above, he's the King of glory, our King of love. Say hallelujah, this King of creation, this King of the nation, and heaven above, he's the King of salvation, and forever the King of my heart. Hallelujah, whoa, this King of glory, our King of love. He's the King of love, he's the King of love. King of love.
All right.
He's going to do that every Sunday as part of his sermon series.
Not going to happen. All right. Now we come to a time of invitation. And rather than have an emotional catharsis, this is a spiritual catharsis. What I mean by that is, if the Lord God is stirring your heart, if the Lord is stirring your spirit, if the Holy Spirit is speaking to you for the very first time, and you have never spoken before men and women and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the King of glory, the King of love. I believe that He is Messiah and that salvation is by Him alone. I want to invite you to come forward and make that public profession of faith before men and women right now. If you just want to unite with this beautiful body of believers that love the Lord so much, you come forward as we sing our invitation.